Yeah. Well, actually, last night I was at the party. Were you at the party? Did you go to?
I did go to the party last night. Yeah. Briefly.
So I met John Lithgow there, mm-hmm. And there was a professor who drove him down. Who was a professor? Are you screening? Are you now on?
I am rolling.
Okay.
You can keep talking.
Where did this journey start for you? Where was the why a film?
Well, you know about my background. I practiced law for 25 years, so I had a story to tell, and I kept waiting for someone else to tell this story, and nobody did. So I thought, okay, I guess it's me, and I named my production company If Not Now Productions.
That's an odd leap, though, isn't it? To say, okay, I'm going to go out and make a documentary.
You know, I'd seen, well, first of all, when I practiced law, I had made 3 short films about cases, about clients. Mm-hmm. My first one was a very severely brain-injured woman, and I couldn't convey to the other side the extent of her injury. So I decided to spend 3 days with her with a camera. And then I went back and interviewed, like, her pastor and her friends and family, people who knew her. She had a very, very severe brain injury, where she had almost no short-term memory. So like you'd meet her and you talked to her, you knew something was off, and then if you walked away and came back 15 minutes later, she wouldn't even know she's ever seen you before. And you couldn't get that unless you spent some time with her. Mm-hmm. So I spent 3 days and I made this short documentary, and I used it to help settle the case, and I realized in that moment how storytelling through film, how effective it could be.
So were the other 2 cases as successful in terms of telling a story?
Yes, absolutely. And well, you know, and as a trial lawyer, I mean, that's what I do. I tell a story. Right. I just tell it to a jury. And I use the people who are on the witness stand. So in some ways, I mean, you've seen the film. We have 4 characters in the film. And each one were sort of like my clients. And the experts in the film were sort of like expert witnesses. And the archival footage in the film was similar to exhibits that I would use at trial. So it was very, it felt very comfortable for me to do this. What I didn't know is the filmmaking part of it. You know, I didn't know what a DP was.
Right.
You know, I didn't know, you know, all the technical stuff. I didn't know about lighting and sound. I didn't know what B-roll was. I didn't know what an establishment shot. I mean, I didn't know any of the technical part. And I just surrounded myself with really experienced filmmakers.
So you did the first 3 little films. Did you do them pretty much by yourself?
Yes.
Or an assistant or?
I had an editor who, like, did the technical part of the editing.
Right.
But I edited. I mean, I figured out what I wanted. I told the story.
Right.
You know, I was the editor, but not, like, the technical move this here and
right.
do that there. But I was directing those as well. I mean, I was the one deciding I've always been the one who asked the questions.
Right.
Who am I interviewing? What's the story? What's the message? All of that.
So did you feel comfortable immediately doing that?
Yes.
It just stuck to water?
Yes. Absolutely. Really, I mean, it was
very
natural.
For you.
Yeah, very natural transition.
Were you a movie person in your life? Were you a big movie fan, or television fan? Or?
You know, I've always liked movies. I've come to love documentaries. We have a film festival in my town. I live in Ashland, Oregon.
Mm-hmm.
And so we have the Ashland Independent Film Festival, and I started going.
It qualifies as a small film festival.
Well, you know, actually, they like to think of themselves as
for
a little
Ashland,
bit bigger.
For Ashland, I'm sure it's a big film festival.
Yeah. And I started going, and I started watching documentary films, and I just love them. And I was going to take a year off from my practice. I was going to take a 1-year sabbatical.
Mm-hmm.
And I had something to say. So I decided to make a documentary film. And then, of course, 1 year turned into 2 years. Mm-hmm. And now it's been 2.5 years.
So do you not consider yourself a documentarian or a lawyer?
Both. You're always a lawyer.
Right.
I mean, I haven't been disbarred, so I'm still a lawyer.
Until this movie comes out.
Yeah, and, you know, I'm on inactive status. So I'm not, you know, I don't, at this moment, I'm still a lawyer, but I'm not practicing law right now. And, you know, I think I can, you know, now that we've been to Sundance and every other film festival and we're going to be on HBO, I think I can call myself a filmmaker, legitimately.
Do you feel the urge to go out and make documentaries about other things?
Yes, absolutely. I definitely have the bug.
Are there legal things or anything?
You know, the truth is that you should always do something that you know.
Right.
So I know the law, and so my next film is actually another legal issue, but it's an international legal issue.
Well, it's funny because some documentarians get into it and they actually do the documentaries to learn things. Like they actually look to things that they really have no idea what it is, so they can kind of investigate and
you
find
know,
their way.
When I was at the closing party at Sundance, mm-hmm. I met another documentary filmmaker, and he said something which just really hit home to me. He said, "Documentary filmmakers get a backstage pass to life." And I thought, isn't that cool? You know, I mean, figure out what do I want to know about? Because mm-hmm. people really do open their doors to documentary filmmakers.
Yeah.
I mean, it shocked me. In a pleasant way.
Well, it's like talking to anybody else, I assume, from your career as a lawyer, that you in interviewing people, that people have an interest in telling you their story.
Not in the legal field. I mean, people, you
well,
know, when
you're...
afraid
to do it, I guess, if you're coming with a lawsuit. But
when you have a camera,
yeah,
you know, everybody secretly wants to be a movie star. You know, so they open their doors. They go, oh, I'm going to be in the movies. You know, and people are fascinated by movies. Mm-hmm. You know, even documentary movies. I mean, everybody wants to talk about it. I mean, to the point where my kids, like... when they go to the doc, the dentist, everybody wants to talk about my movie, and they're sort of like, okay, I'm done with this already.
So did you start doing this movie with the story about the coffee and McDonald's?
No. Actually, as lawyers, we're basically told to stay away from that case because everybody thinks they know it,
right,
and most people assume that it's a frivolous lawsuit, it's ridiculous. And if you're talking to a jury, you don't want to like challenge them too much that they're
right.
wrong. So as lawyers, as trial lawyers in particular, we're told, you know, stay away from that case because you're not going to change people's minds.
Right.
So originally, I had wrote an outline of the film back in the summer of 2008.
Uh-huh.
And I knew what the topics were that I wanted to cover in the film, but I didn't know what the stories were. And the name of the film initially was Distorted, with mm-hmm. the tort, you know, has justice been sold? And then I realized very soon, as you know from the film, nobody knows what a tort is, let alone what tort reform is. They just, you know, so nobody would really get the joke.
Right.
And
I know what a tort is, and I find them delicious.
Okay, good.
Both kind of torts work for me.
Good. And I went to Sundance in 2009, mm-hmm. and I watched a lot of documentaries to see what works, what doesn't work. You know, I was just
You kind of went as a civilian.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I went as a civilian in 2009 and 2010. And I saw a movie called Good Hair. Do you remember that film with
Chris Rock?
Movie,
yeah.
And I liked the way Good Hair sounded. I don't know what something about it like touched
right.
me. And I came back home, back to Ashland, and I started mm-hmm. researching to start the film. And I read an article that said that the McDonald's coffee case is the most infamous case in the world. Everybody knows it, or at mm-hmm. least they think they do. And in that moment, I said, the movie is Hot Coffee. And it was like everything clicked into place. It was sort of like the domino, like, you know, everything like clicked mm-hmm. in. It was like perfect. And I knew in that moment, this is the film mm-hmm. and this is the title. And this is what's going to get people into the theater mm-hmm. because everybody sort of thinks they know it, you know. And what
so
people realize is that they don't.
So is getting the family to talk to you hard at all, or were they just anxious to talk?
Very hard. No. So what happened was is that I went to Albuquerque, New Mexico cold.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I knew that I needed two things. I needed the jurors because they were the ones who were ridiculed. You know. So I really wanted to talk to jurors, and I needed the family. And I didn't know anybody. I didn't even know the family's name because the woman who this happened to, Stella Liebach, was deceased and her family didn't have the same last name. So I went to Albuquerque. I got a copy. I went to the courthouse. I'm a lawyer, right? So I went to the courthouse. I pulled the file. Which is public knowledge. I actually got a copy of the transcript mm-hmm. of the trial from some professors up in Washington State who wrote a book and read through the transcript and got the names of the jurors. But you have to remember, it happened back in the event happened in 1992. The trial was in 1994. This is 2009. You know, trying to find those people and whether they would talk to me, all of that was... not easy. And I called several people trying to find them. I found them on the internet.
Right.
Many people were like, who are you? Why do you want to do this? Why are you bringing this up again? We already were ridiculed. We don't want to be made fun of anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, just meet with me. You know, just talk to me. I want to tell you. I want to tell the truth.
Right.
And they did. And, you know, you have to develop a sense of trust.
Uh-huh.
And it was the same thing with the family. And I knew if I didn't have the family, I didn't have anything. If I didn't have the grandson who could go back and drive through, because he was the driver, as you know.
Right.
If I didn't have them, I didn't have a film. So I met with them, talked to them for a while.
So you were so committed at that point to the idea that this was central to what the movie was going to be.
Now, at that point,
the entire film falls apart without that story.
I mean, at that point, the movie was called Hot Coffee. If I didn't have the McDonald's coffee case, what did I have?
Uh-huh.
And
had you already determined in your own mind at that point what was real and what was false about that story?
Oh, I knew that as a lawyer. Most lawyers know that.
Everybody knows. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the truth has been out.
It's a secret that you just don't want to really talk about because it irritates jurors.
No, it's not that it's you want to irritate. Yeah, it's not that it's an open secret. It's that when you're trying a case,
right.
you're asking the jury for something. So the last thing you want to do is somehow insult them at the beginning by telling them you're wrong about this.
Right.
As lawyers, what we're told is distinguish your case from the McDonald's coffee case. Almost sort of acknowledge that it's frivolous so right. that you can say, well, you know, can you imagine that there are some cases that are not like that case, that right. are not frivolous? When in fact, as you know, most people who see the film, right. after they see it, they say, why did I think that this was frivolous?
Well, you know,
why
was I? Picture of her legs, and that's right. it. You're
yeah, done. Well, not her yeah. legs. It's more than her legs.
Yes, but I mean the whole inner, that yeah. whole inner thigh shot. Once you see that, it changes. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's an audible gasp in the yeah. audience when those pictures are shown.
So you got to the family. You knew the story well enough to tell them what your perspective on it was and where you were going with this.
You know, I told them I just wanted to tell the truth. You know, I wanted the truth to come out, finally, because almost everybody knows the case and almost right. everybody has it completely wrong.
Yeah.
And it's not their fault. I mean, it was reported that way. You know, Jane Pauley was substituting for Tom Brokaw as the anchor on the NBC Nightly News right. the night that the verdict came out and reported to the world that she was driving. Mm-hmm. When in fact, you know, she wasn't. She was in a parked car. She was a passenger in a parked car.
So they went for it. Obviously.
They went for it. You know what was the clincher? Yeah. The grandson, whose name is Cristiano, and I went out for lunch. And we were talking.
No drive-thru, I hope.
No. We were in a restaurant. And these two waitresses came over. They were young. They were like 20 years old. Mm-hmm. And he asked them, do you remember the story of a woman who spilled coffee? And they go, oh, yeah, McDonald's, ha, ha, ha. They were 20 years old. I mean, they were like, what, 5 years old when it happened and they right. knew it? And I knew that when he started asking those questions, that he was hooked, that yeah. he wanted to be part of this. And then, you know, I everything that I did from then on was exactly what I told them what I was going to do. I mean, I developed a level of trust, and I stuck to it. I mean, I made a film to tell the truth, and people are hungering for the truth.
Okay, so in this film, you tell the truth about this story in mm-hmm. about the first 20 minutes, and then you have the rest of the tale, which is right. much more complicated, much more about law and the way we see things and mm-hmm. the social issues and everything else. Did you know that there's a trick? It's challenging as a filmmaker to actually go from, you know, here's your bait. It's called hot coffee. Mm-hmm. You got the McDonald's thing out of the way, and now we're going to give you the movie you didn't expect to see.
Mm-hmm.
Were you conscious of that as you went into the process, or did you?
Well, you know, I knew, as I said, I knew what the issues were that I wanted to deal with. I wasn't sure exactly how it was all going to fit together until we got into the editing room. Initially, I thought I was going to have these four storylines and that they were going to sort of be intertwined with each other in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't until my editor, Cindy Lee, and I, who's fabulous, by the way, greatest editor, and you know, she and I talked about it, and it just, I was a little nervous about having almost four separate storylines.
Right.
And initially, until pretty much the end, we didn't have the hook that pulled them all together. I mean, I knew as a lawyer how they all fit together. I knew right. that there were four different ways that we as Americans are giving up our rights to access the court system. But when I did my rough cut at the beginning, I had these four different storylines and we just sort of have titles in between. And it was, I had a few people say, well, I sort of get it by the end,
right.
but as we're going along, I don't really know that this is all happening. So at that point, I had to figure out, well, what can I do to sort of pull them all together? And of course, since I'm a lawyer, I thought, okay, well, they're exhibit one, exhibit two, exhibit three, right. exhibit four. And as you know from the film, I mean, you know, we sort of have these graphics that show as if it's like, as if you're in a lawyer's office and, you know, right. the folders opens up and there's the exhibits for that section in there.
Mm-hmm.
And when we came up with that sort of format and then did the introduction that sort of showed these are all the different ways that we are giving up our rights, it sort of all gelled in that moment.
Right.
And as you know, I mean, I think what, at least what I've been told is that the movie sort of builds. You know, like you see this McDonald's case, you see the truth behind it, and right. then the machine, the corporate machine that used, you know, the false information for political reasons to convince us to give up our rights, the public mm-hmm. relations campaign, so to speak. And then I wanted to show, okay, well, what's happened? What's happened legislatively? What's happened in terms of our elections, our judicial elections? And then what's happening right this minute that all of us are doing every day, and right. we don't even know we're doing it. We're signing away our rights through these contracts. And it all just sort of I don't know. I believe in intention, you know. Mm-hmm. I had something to say, and I wanted to say it in a way that people would understand, right. And it's just all fell into place perfectly.
You don't know how to describe it, but you know what it looks like when you say it.
Well, yeah, that's right. You know, I am one of those people, though. You know, I can envision whatever it is out here. Right. I don't have any idea how I'm going to get there. It's like, mm-hmm. This is my intention, and the mechanism of how to get there, I don't even pay attention to that. As long as my intention is real and strong, and I know I can see it here, I know, right. I'll get there, and I'll get there in whatever way gets me there.
Well, it's an interesting phenomenon, because when I saw the picture at Sundance. At Sundance, it was, you know, the lead line for it was, you know, McDonald's coffee. Mm-hmm. That's the name of the movie, obviously. And then you go to the theater, and you're like, you get through the McDonald's coffee story, you get to the next story, and you're kind of like, how are we going to fill the next hour and, you know, 10 minutes or whatever it is? And then you kind of get pulled into the rest of it, not really realizing that's where you're going at all.
Mm-hmm.
And it's compelling. And it's not, you know, at first you're like a little ticked off, maybe perhaps this is not what you were sold. And then it turns out it was something better, in a way, than just that one story.
Well, thank you.
But it's an interesting good-bad problem to have. You know?
Yeah. Well, people tell me all the time, you know, they walk in thinking one thing, and they walk out thinking something very different. Yeah. And most people say, you know, it's an eye-opening movie. You know, that they walk in and they say, I thought I was smart. I thought I was an informed person, you know, and I didn't know this stuff.
Well, you do get a feeling that the government and the people in the government, anytime there's any issue, really, that if somebody like yourself looks at it closely enough, we see all the strings. And then all of a sudden it's not as, you know, it doesn't make as good television as it does when you don't. It's very scary. I mean, the Anthony Weiner thing is a classic example of, you know, we're looking at Anthony Weiner and his tweets,
mm-hmm.
and we're not looking at, you know, Afghanistan, and we're not looking
right.
at, you know.
Right. Well, the other thing that's a little scary, and this is the media, really, is, you know, we don't know the source behind the information that we're getting. So, for example, I was at the Little Rock Film Festival a couple weeks ago, where we screened at the Bill Clinton School for Public Service.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy comes up to me and says, I'm a reporter for this newspaper I hadn't never heard of. And he said, oh, and by the way, my newspaper is owned by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And first, I was really grateful to him to have explained that, you know, to say that to me, to be open about it. And then I thought, how ironic is this? You know, this guy's going to write an article or a review or whatever about the movie. And it's going to go into all these small newspapers around the country, you know, that they are affiliates with, right?
Right.
And no one who reads those papers is going to know that this guy who wrote it is paid by the entity that we basically, you know, expose in
right.
the film. And yet they're going to think that what he's writing is real and is, you know, legitimate and it's, you know, real. And what's ironic about it is that's what my movie's about. You know, the fact that we're being fed information as a society, you know, for a variety of reasons. You know, it sells papers, it's, you know, it's sexy, whatever. And it becomes part of our popular culture,
mm-hmm.
and people start to believe it.
Yeah, you repeat it enough times, people believe it.
Well, it's like the Sunday morning shows, you know. Don't you ever, I mean, when it's like, okay, everybody got the same memo this morning. You know, repeat these words over and over again.
Well, you see it on Fox, and then you see it on MSNBC, and you see it on NPR, and you hear the same phrases.
Right.
Like, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the same phrase gets repeated, you know, 200 times in a week.
And, you know, those phrases are market tested. You know, there's on our DVDs, we're mm-hmm. going to have an extras.
Uh-huh.
And didn't make it into the film. But, you know, we show how there are people who are hired to market test terms. Mm. So the terms like frivolous lawsuit, lawsuit lottery, jackpot justice,
right.
they were all market tested to determine what people are going to relate to.
Mm.
So it's sort of like what used to be a state tax, right?
Right.
Now it's called the death tax, or it was at the last election.
Mm.
Well, that was made up. It's the same exact law.
Right.
It's just, okay, well, let's see what term we can use that will get people angry or feel like they're being threatened in some way. And let's use that term over and over again.
Well, we just saw Obamacare go from a term of the day to I'm avoiding that term within 3 days.
Right.
Because it just tested badly, apparently. It
did
not work with this constituency. So out the window it went.
Mm-hmm.
So there's kind of no end to this. I mean, it's an interesting problem because there's no... Somebody, I mean, there must be, well, I guess trial lawyer, I guess the corporations are sincere about not wanting to have tort reform.
No, they want tort reform.
But I mean, they're sincere because they want what they want. I mean, it's an interesting balance between what people need and people are, they're in the business of having. You know, it's their, it makes sense for a corporation to want the reform.
Well, they want to make more money. I mean, they're, right. what they're you know, their bylaws or whatever is sort of, you know, if they don't, if they're not trying to make money, there could be, you know, their, what do they call them? The shareholders
right.
can go after them because they're supposed to make money, right?
Which is crazy in a way. But and individuals are not activated until something actually happens to them.
Well, nobody
so
cares.
Like you get activated and deactivated
right.
unless you drop the coffee in your lap.
Yeah, I mean, like these people, like even the family, frankly, they were really conservative people. And they, it's so ironic. It's sort of like, it's never my lawsuit that's frivolous. It's
right.
always your lawsuit or that person's lawsuit that's frivolous. And we don't care. It's not just about this, it's anything. We don't usually care or get invested until it affects us personally or our family or a friend. And who wants to talk about the legal system in terms of, you know, tort reform, mandatory arbitration? These are boring words, right? Who wants to talk about those until you need it? And then all of a sudden you need it and you go, wait a second, I thought I lived in a democracy. You know, I thought I had rights. I mean, this is our third branch of government. We're supposed to get justice. When I was practicing law, people would come into my office and I'd say, look, I will work 100% for you. I believe in your case, all of this, but if you are expecting justice in the end, I cannot guarantee that. Because the people who are sitting on these juries, they've already, you know, they believe something that isn't necessarily true. And, you know, but I said, but I'm going to work really hard, you know, to get justice for you, but I can't guarantee.
Well, when the machinery on the other side is in place 24/7, 365 days a year, I'm stuttering all of a sudden. That's pretty strange. I've become a stutterer in this conversation. But when they're in place all the time and they're moving in that direction all the time, and individuals are only getting excited about it when they happen to have something bad happen to them and need the lawsuit legal system, it's kind of an impossible fight.
And also the truth is that the people who are consumers or victims, they don't have the resources
right.
to combat the public relations campaign. And so it is a bit of a losing battle, which is why we need Congress to step up and say that these mandatory arbitration clauses are illegal. We can't have them. And in fact, Senator Franken, who's in the film, as you know, has reintroduced the Arbitration Fairness Act to try to get those clauses out of contracts. People are signing them away all the time, as you know, and don't realize that they're doing it until they need it. And also, you know, I'm hoping, you know, in almost every state right this minute, there are laws that are being established to take away people's rights by putting caps on damages and other things. And I've been doing, you know, Q&As all over the country, and I usually ask, how many people know what the cap is in this state? Nobody knows. They don't even know that there is a cap, you know, unless there's a lawyer in the audience.
And are we all signing away more legal things now, signing more legal documents than we ever realized we would?
Absolutely.
Internet and everything?
Well, you can't do anything without...
Except.
Right. And who reads them?
Nobody.
Right. My daughter...
lawyers reading them.
My daughter just got a new phone, and before she could activate the phone, you know, there's like recording, and it says, please be advised that in order to activate the phone, you are subject to a mandatory arbitration clause. In order to activate your phone, please press 1. You know, if you don't press 1, you don't activate your phone. And if you don't press 1 and activate your phone, you know, you have to be, you're subject to this clause.
Yeah.
And who even knows what it means, you know, until Jamie Lee Jones, by the way, as we know, who's the young woman in Iraq, you know, who went to Iraq and was brutally assaulted, raped, and, you know, she signs away her rights through her employment contract, doesn't know or care. And now she's actually in court right now.
Right.
She's her trial started this week. So it took 6 years for her to get to trial because she was fighting this arbitration clause.
And aren't the courts designed on some level, isn't the law designed on some level, so that if the contract you've signed is unfairly foisted upon you, that there is a way of surviving it?
You know...
Or is it just that it's so hard to get through that layer that you never get to the point where you can actually have a case?
You know, there are certain times when those kinds of clauses can be challenged in the court, but for the most part... people are reading these things and they're signing them. So they're voluntarily giving up their rights. You know, we can't protect people for not understanding their, you know, we can't say, oh, well, you know, you're excused because you didn't understand it. You shouldn't have signed it if you didn't understand it. right? So the problem.
If you want your phone to work, you have
well,
to push one.
Well, that right.
And who knows what the and it doesn't say. And if you don't want to push one, do this. Here's the alternative. It'll take you 2 weeks, but you can do it.
Right. There is no alternative.
There's no alternative offered.
Right. Which is why we have to get this passed through legislation. Yeah. You know what's so crazy about this also? You know, I talk about, you know, in the film, as you know, I do this little animation, you know, mm-hmm. of the three branches of government. And I do it in a cartoon because it's so fundamental. It's like what we learn in elementary school, mm-hmm. right? That's why I do it that way.
Schoolhouse Rock.
Right. Well, although it's not Schoolhouse Rock. We actually made up that animation.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
And the thing about it is that, you know, we have, you know, we know that our legislative branch and our executive branch are influenced so dramatically by money, but most mm-hmm. people think that our courts are fair, right? That they're, that, you know, they should be fair, you know, they're judges. Mm-hmm. They don't understand how much money is being spent now because we elect our judges. And mm-hmm. So it's, I lost my train of thought when you asked me that other question. So what's so interesting is that, you know, there are all these people who are like big on the Constitution, right? The mm-hmm. Tea Partiers and everything. Well, the Seventh Amendment to the Constitution is trial by jury. It's the Seventh Amendment. It's like they forget about that one. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, well, we believe in all these other amendments, but we don't believe in this amendment.
That
right, that one doesn't suit us.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's a fundamental right that we're giving away.
No, we do it all. Well, it's interesting. It's almost like the legal profession, through all these corporations and through all the this stuff that's now so automated, almost precludes using the legal system. I mean, so it seems like the machinery is so tight and the machinery is so, you're signing off on every single thing you do every day. You know, you probably sign 5 legal documents a day, not realizing you're even signing them, just saying agree, 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 agree.
Right.
And how do you know, unless something truly egregious happens, where you really need the legal system and you're desperate for the legal system, who's going to even consider starting down that road?
Well, and you know, right now, I don't know if you happen to know
and
this,
even
but
the family in the movie with the coffee was saying basically, if McDonald's had done the right thing in the first place and just paid their legal bills,
not legal bills,
damage,
just the difference between what Medicare paid and what our medical bills were.
Yeah.
That's all they asked for.
None of it would have happened.
And McDonald's, you know, they offered $800 all through. You know, even at the end, most people, of course, don't know this, but I actually interviewed the mediator. There was a mediation about a month before the trial. Mm. And the lawyer for the family said, if McDonald's offers $50,000 at that point, mm-hmm. I won't even take a fee. Mm. You can just have the money. And they never offered more than $800. You know. And the other thing that's really interesting is that, you know, in the film where I show McDonald's actually gave in discovery, in as mm-hmm. part of the case, all the names of all these other people who had been injured, 700 right. of them. But the lawyer who represented Mrs. Leback had mm-hmm. represented another woman 6 years before, also against McDonald's for a burn case. Mm. And her name wasn't on the list. Mm. And the list was supposed to have all the names of the right. people who had paid. So in cross-examination, he said to the quality assurance guy, that guy who was a little pompous that was right. in the film, he said, so where's Mrs. So-and-so? You know, remember I was right. representing her and you paid me money? Where is she on this list? And he goes, oh, I don't know. And he goes, well, how many other people aren't on this list? You know, you gave us 700 names, but how many are not? Because we know that it's not complete. And the jury just got really angry. You know, it was a unanimous verdict, by the way.
Well, I think people on both sides of it just want to feel like the world is fair on some level. I always think that's true, like in the film business, it's always about piracy these days, and people are stealing, kids are stealing. I think people are willing to pay for things. They just don't want to feel like they're being ripped off.
And yeah.
If the world felt fair, then people would just accept, even if it wasn't that fair, they would accept it.
But that's life, right?
Yeah. But on the flip side, you have corporations that are designed not to be fair.
Right.
They're designed to grow.
In this world, what they've done, brilliantly, by the way, mm-hmm. is they figured out ways to prevent people from accessing the court system. Mm-hmm. Because if you prevent people from accessing the court system, then they can make more money because you right. can't hold them accountable.
Yeah.
So corporations that make products that kill us, like cigarettes mm-hmm. or baby formula or cribs that, you know, or whatever, or BP that dumps, you know, billions of gallons of oil into our seas, we can't hold them accountable if we can't access the courts. And that's exactly what all of this has been about.
Yeah. No, it's even, Harry Shearer did a documentary this year about
The Big Uneasy.
Mm-hmm. And it's about the Army Corps of Engineers mm-hmm. not only screwing up, but then the cover-up following it and how they used all these different forms, that they basically become a corporation. This thing that was meant to be a governmental goodwill, essentially, mm-hmm. and a positive governmental issue, and now they've become an organization that's so busy defending itself and making sure it's not, its image is not damaged and that it's perceived a certain way and it's making the money it's supposed to make, that they don't seem to care anymore. And you look at individuals and you go, okay, that person seems like a decent person, that seems a person. But yet the machinery is almost like, it's like the Borg. It's like Star Trek. It's like a strange.
We have to all assimilate.
Yeah, but and yet we don't. Look at the thing with Chevron and another documentarian this year, and who that case has been shoved back out of the courts again.
You mean the Crude?
The Crude case, yeah. Where you just can't. It's very hard to win against the machine that already is established, mm-hmm. and it's hard for people to find the energy to do it
because they have so much money that they can keep.
And time,
right.
Human life is limited. Corporations go on forever, mm-hmm. I guess. And then, of course, even with lawyers, we don't know, is a trial lawyer a good person or an evil person? Because there's that constant argument.
Well, they're good when you need them, right? It's like, nobody wants to talk about it. Of course, the word trial lawyer, just so you know, this is another market-tested thing. When did trial lawyer become a bad term?
Yeah.
First of all, lawyers who defend cases are also trial lawyers. It's like criminal lawyers are trial lawyers. It's any lawyer who goes into the courtroom is a trial lawyer, but yet there's been this big, huge public relations campaign to demonize these lawyers because they represent injured people.
Right.
Some
of them are scumbags, though.
I'm not big on advertising, lawyer advertising. I think that was the demise of the professionalism, when you start advertising on a bus, side of a bus. Okay. Yeah. I wish that weren't true. But the truth is that it's not the lawyers who bring these cases, it's the clients who bring the cases. Right. And the truth is that most of the time, look, I practice law, and I'm very proud of it. I was a really good lawyer, mm-hmm. and I represented injured people, and I'm an ethical person. And, the lawyers, for the most part, are the gatekeepers, mm-hmm. because the truth is that they only make money if they win. People don't remember that. They think, they're going to bring a lot of frivolous lawsuits. They can't bring frivolous lawsuits because insurance companies are not throwing money at frivolous lawsuits.
Right.
And lawyers, if they bring frivolous lawsuits, how many of them are they going to win? And they only make a percentage usually of what the jury awards or what the settlement is. And then there's all this myth about, frivolous medical malpractice cases. It's crazy. Do you know how much money it costs to bring a medical malpractice case? Right. Do you know how hard it is bring them?
It does seem, though, there's a lot of, some lawyers are about the settlement, and some lawyers are about, make sure you go to the doctor 16 more times than you need to so you get paid that by the insurance company and then...
But insurance companies are not stupid. They don't pay out frivolous lawsuits. They don't pay out for stuff like that. Frankly, when you have a legitimate case, it's hard to get paid. It's hard to settle a legitimate case. And then... Even if you win at trial, appeal after appeal after appeal, delay. Nobody ever talks about frivolous defenses.
Yeah.
They only talk about the frivolous lawsuit. And we have checks and balances in the system, even in the McDonald's case. The judge reduced the verdict. How many people know that? When was that reported?
No, McDonald's doesn't want to report it.
Right.
They want to suffer. They're on the cross, so to speak. So is there an answer? We're going to have, 12 documentaries from you over the next 25 years and then say, okay, now we figured out what to do? Or is it just so big that you can only see it when you're very close?
Okay, so this is what I believe. Okay, I believe that each one of us has the ability to make change. All right, I made this film to get it out to the world that there's another point of view, that you have rights, that you need to know what they are. And I say, look, I'm handing you the baton now. Now it's your turn to make the next step, to tell people. This morning on my Facebook page, mm-hmm. somebody wrote that she was at like a car dealership this morning, mm-hmm. and she overheard this other woman talking and saying something about the McDonald's coffee case, mm-hmm. all right? And she went right up to her and said, you know what? You've got it wrong. You got to go see this movie, Hot Coffee. You got to go. And she gave her my website, hotcoffeethemovie.com. And she said, you got to know your facts before you start doing it. And I thought, wow. Isn't that great? Each one of us, and people all the time are coming up to me, I haven't stopped talking about your movie. I tell everybody about your movie. Everybody has to see this movie. There's actually a high school curriculum that's looking to put the movie in this high school curriculum.
It makes sense.
And so the point is that it's I'm one person, you know? Yeah, I made a movie. I have a lot of energy, as you can see, right? I made a movie, and I made a movie because I had passion about this. I mean, I really do care about our system, and I really care about people. And now I'm saying, okay, you guys, it's your turn now. You take the next step. You call your congressman. You find out what your rights are. You tell people when they've got it wrong. Don't let people make jokes about this stuff. Take control of our system. Instead of letting other people always constantly bombard us and take things away from us, you know, let's have some spine, you know? Let's have some backbone and stand up for ourselves.
Well, people don't really realize that what the price they're paying for not investing.
Right. Say no to a mandatory arbitration clause. Say, I want this part of it out.
Yeah.
You know? And the truth is that if enough of us do that, then they're going to have to because... Like, I have a realtor. I'm putting my house on the market. Mm-hmm. And it had a mandatory arbitration clause in it. And I said, you know what? I really like you, and I would like to work with you, but I can't have this in here, so unless you take it out, I'm going somewhere else.
Right.
Now, one person, maybe she won't care. Five people, she'll start caring. Right. 10 people, you know, if all of us, if we actually know.
Yeah. No, if 2% of people actually said something, it would change.
Right.
Corporations
half the time, the people who are giving you these contracts don't even know that it's in there or what it means.
Yeah. Or care.
And wouldn't sign it themselves.
That's right.
I always say, you know, we'll have safe nuclear power plants when the president of the nuclear power company and his family live next door to the nuclear power plant.
Yeah.
Right? And it's just like that with everything. You do it first, and then...
You see it when you go to, you know, a store for your cell phone, back to your cell phone, and you say something about what the company is making you do or isn't mm-hmm. doing for you, and you see the people behind the counter rolling their eyes because they know exactly what the right thing to do is and how it may not be that many more expensive for the company to do it the right way, and yet they're sitting there going, can't do anything.
Yeah. I have a friend... And when he's forced to sign these mandatory arbitration, because sometimes you don't have a choice, mm-hmm. right? So instead of writing his name, he always writes, no effing way. That's his signature.